are, well, we are the professionals, you are, so we have to go rooting and tooting, and you have just delivered it in a report. So it's not a criticism, just a point of clarity for the public and ourselves.
Yeah. play with the system and how it works, get the alarm bells started ringing, and that causes quite uncertainty, but it gives a bit more clarity around where we are in the process. And there will be areas where there will be issues with local authorities because they're not giving them that major input, and that's why we look at all different schemes, because we have to deliver on this through the council body. But if you look in this scrap, we're one of the biggest culprits. If you say you take that on the large bid, the large spending, so it doesn't tell you the real picture. The large spending could come right at the end of the process or the middle of the process, but it's not that cloudy. And I'm not sure, I'd like to have that conversation with the director and how we get to the panel, probably a bit more robust and robust.
Yeah, that's right.
I can then move recommendation in paragraph 2 of the report. Oh, my apologies, John, sorry.
Sorry, Chair, just a very brief point under section 310, please. That's your opinion. Clearly, we're unsuccessful in the RTF 2015-16 round. It mentions in this paragraph about following feedback. I wonder what the feedback was, and I wonder why.
Feedback that we had in relation to the 15-16 submission was that they weren't satisfied that we were able to demonstrate sufficient value for money in the approach proposed by our particular programme. And again, that needs clarification in what it has to mean by that. And I think it needs to be clearly understood that the submission was pre-CA. The assessment had to be come across as post-CA, the awards come across to post-CA. Feedback that we've had in the past for me with the DFT and their lead on LSTF to make sure that there's 100% clarity on this. But the feedback that we get is that when we're looking to deliver similar schemes across different districts, in the Liverpool City region, they're struggling to see where that represents full value of money, where we could have a consistent approach, consistent measures, centrally coordinated. That's the particular role that they're looking for, the particular issue that they highlight. But that is not based on any written feedback and definitive feedback. We're looking to get that when we have the opportunity to meet with the DFT.
Thank you. So for future bids, essentially what we're saying is we just need to fine-tune and be more precise. They clearly need to give us more precise feedback and that will enable us to access the budget in the future.
And that picks up did have a meeting earlier on in the week with the LSTM board, and the point that was made at that particular point is as a consequence of how we previously approached an LSTM, this is how we've got what do we need to change to make sure that we can maximise the potential for us to secure optimal levels of funding as we progress. And there is under the LSTF revenue element, we have a current spend, but it's a consequence of optimism bias. gone back to DfT to ask, given that we were successful with that 15-16, our resilience plan is, can we carry forward this 1.6 million into 15-16? Well, here's what we're going to do differently to ensure that in doing that, carrying that forward, we can deliver more effectively and efficiently on the schemes that we're looking to progress as part of the work that we've had from the growth in response.
This is really a self-managing question. I don't know if you can say this or not. So, excuse me, I'm not being prepared. But Alex is really in the city region now. Is there an issue here with the emergency schemes can be held back a little bit and cut down short on the skills and numbers that we're doing in the future? So, I don't know if there's an ability to look at how difficult our schemes could have.
Thank you.
first test coaching week, but that's their preferred option, but they've only brought that forward on the 26th of August. And they're also raising concerns now about the time frame between now and 27th of October to do all the necessary testing. And I think we would probably agree that there is significant pressure now on the testing. And I think we are clear in here that stagecoach have withdrawn all technical support for the project. Therefore, there's an obvious logic that if you're not bringing any resources and you're only just starting something now rather than several months ago, then it will be under pressure. And I think that will significantly bring the proposed timeline to a significant challenge. I think it's very, very difficult to do that without full commitment. But they both wanted me to draw to your attention the fact that they would prefer, because of the lack of resources and time for testing, and their concerns about the safe work product being the product to be required, that they would prefer to do solo. And the final element is a reader in particular saying, we should sort out the governance of the scheme before we start talking about smart. But again, you've heard that before, it's reflected in here, but it's only fair that I bring that to your attention because we did get those comments just a little bit late on. I guess the more substantial update is that there was a meeting on the 26th of August, and there was another meeting yesterday with central government, hosted by Baroness Kramer, about the Smart Cities rollout project. And there was a follow-up meeting with the regional stagecoach about trying to unblock some of this work. I think it's fair to say that we've had fairly open and transparent and very robust conversations with the operators about this, and I think it's fair to say that the Department of Transport are fully supportive of the way that we're approaching it. They're very supportive of the work that Liz Paul and others have put in place in the governance and the arrangements, and they understand the logic, and actually there is a logic because we've got a lot of time into doing that. And they are being very supportive in encouraging the operators to reconsider the use of using the same ways as the initial stage. And there was a verbal discussion yesterday and a verbal offer by stagecoach Arriva about how we might move this forward. I think what I need to do is just make sure I get that in writing before I start to talk to you today. But we are saying that they should look at safe way. We don't believe if they were fully committed and resources in place, we think this could be delivered as a project and it would test out, say, smart on an existing product. And I have to say that it's very neatly alongside what central government are trying to do. They're trying to get something delivered that they can see rather than create more and more complexity. And so it's been very helpful to have Baroness Kramer and the DOT's team supporting in that action. So we are awaiting their proposition on how to move forward on a safer way, and also their desire to also push resources into solo as well. I think the final point that Arriva Stagecoach wants me to draw to your attention, but in Oxford, Go Ahead and Stagecoach believe that they've got a very good two-operator product rating to a frame between two operators, and Arriva are attempting to join that scheme to make it a frame between three operators, and they are holding that up as the national exemplar how it would work. There's some technical problems, so Arriva can't join it at the moment, but they are holding that up as the way forward. And as part of their offer, they will formally want to invite a small group of members from here to go down to Oxford to see what they can talk about. I don't see a problem with doing that at the same time as continuing to press with the Dream Arrow project. But I did say I would raise that here today. I did say I didn't think there was going to be a problem with probably the lead members going down and seeing this in operation at the same time as encouraging them to get on and do the Merseyside scheme. So that's where we are. This is red. The timescale for 27th of October is severely under pressure. But what we've always said to you is, that's the project plan. We're not going to just slip it back. That's the project plan. And we've been absolutely clear that we want operators to fully engage with us. And when they do, we will rebase the project plan and come back for your approval to change the date. We're not just going to keep slipping it back. And there's no doubt that retaining that date in the programme is bringing pressure to bear on them, because we're saying that's what we've committed to do. We're working with small operators, so 10% of the market is already effectively being equipped and ready to go. So it's not a brilliant story.